After an eventful and enlightening first half session, I, Darshna Male,
and I, Chinmay Didwania,
welcome you all back to enjoy the business convention 2K16.
Our minds are rejuvenated and are raring to learn and understand more from the corporate stalwarts.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Harsh Sood, Senior Vice President and Head HR and OD, Union National Bank, UAE.
I would like to call upon Dr. Dimple Sani, Director, Corporate Relations, to welcome our guest with a bouquet.
Thank you, ma'am. May we now call upon Rahul Mundra, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of Telecom and Management, to introduce, sir.
Thank you, Darshna, ma'am. A very good afternoon to one and all present. I have the privilege of introducing our guest speaker for this session, Mr. Harsh Sood. Harsh Sood has over 23 years of experience across industries such as banking, telecom sectors, FMCG, oil lubricants, and automotive sectors in HR and OD function. Sir is currently holding the position of Senior Vice President and Head HR and OD, Union National Bank. Before Union National Bank, Harsh Sood sir has served Bharti Airtel Limited, Castrol India Limited, and Apollo Tyres Limited. Sir is alumni of Symbus Institute of Business Management and Delhi University. Sir, now I request you to please enlighten us with your words of wisdom. The dice is all yours, sir. Thank you.
So good afternoon, everyone. No, sir, please. Okay, I'm extremely grateful to Professor Bala, first of all, for giving me this opportunity to be here to stand in front of you. I don't know, maybe some of you are aware, I was amongst the first few students who were under the tutelage of Professor Bala in Symbiosis Institute of Business Management. He was our HOD for MPM. And it's been a tremendous experience, those 1.5 years or so, being under that phenomenal individual, human being, and institution in himself. I have a very difficult task today. Immediately post lunch, I'm sure all of you would have enjoyed your lunch. Yes? So you'll make my life easy by falling asleep? I said no, sir. There is no sir. I'm here in front of you as a colleague, as a friend. It's just that I have a little bit more experience than you in terms of what the corporate world is all about, and probably have worked in a few sectors as one of your colleagues just introduced. So let's make a deal. You will all doze off or you'll listen to me? So the deal is you'll listen to me. We'll make this session interactive. While I would not like any interruptions, but if you have an important comment as I go along, just raise your hand. And for the benefit of everyone around in this hall, just make that comment, yeah? So I don't mind interjections, but I would mind if there's an interruption. Fair point? Yeah? So I'll share with you what are some of the competencies which are required for having a successful corporate career, okay? How many of us want to be successful in life? There are some who are still thinking about it, or? I think it should be a resounding, probably you should raise both your hands. Yeah? Okay. That is just to keep the energy up. I want to make sure that you don't doze off. So over the next few minutes, we'll talk about what is this corporate world all about, what is happening in the economic environment. I'll try and bring in a different perspective. Incidentally, I've been away from India in terms of my working life for more than 12 years. So my perspective is going to be more what is happening in the global world or what is happening in Middle East in particular. So I want to share that perspective, and of course I'm coming from an industry which is different from what you guys are predominantly oriented towards, which is telecom. Okay, so we will see how that is relevant for you. We'll talk about some of those aspects, and then we'll get into what are those specific competencies. And please note that I'm talking of competencies and not just skills in terms of ensuring success and ensuring effectiveness. Is that something which gels with everyone, or you want me to change some of it? It's fine? So, okay, so some of the things which we'll walk through. What is the current economic environment? How this is impacting the business scenario? What are the challenges for young professionals like you and for professionals at large? How do we build competence which is sustainable? Okay, it's not just something which is going to hold true and which is going to apply for the next 1 or 2 years or 5 years, but something which is going to be sustainable over a long period of time. Finally, we'll talk about leading without a title and small win principles. Okay, you know who came up with this phrase, lead without a title? Who knows about it? Come on guys, let's make it interactive. You all know much more than the speakers who are standing over here. I was quite impressed with the interaction I had with some of your colleagues, students. So tell me, who's come up with this phrase, lead without title? Robin Sharma? Okay, so I'll share a small video with you on what Robin Sharma says about effectiveness and leading. Okay, so this is what the agenda is, and as I said, I'll try to keep it as light as possible, knowing fully well that as human beings, after we've consumed food, we obviously like to let our minds and our bodies rest. Finally, what is growth and what is fulfillment of potential all about? Okay, this is a little bit of conceptual part of the entire address, but we will see if time permits, we'll get into this. So what is happening in the current global environment? Who would like to talk about? Anyone? Just one or two bullets. What is top of your mind? Brexit, IoT? One at a time. Okay. Brexit is, yes, it's happening. Overall, the sentiment at a global level is somewhat subdued. Yeah, of course, there's a lot of vibrance as far as the Indian corporate firmament is concerned. But if you look at the West, you look at Europe in particular, if you look at US, Canada, that region, the sentiment is somewhat subdued. Yes, and this is something which applies even in countries like China. There's a lot of volatility, whether it's in terms of currency, whether it's in terms of, you know, the exports as far as China is concerned, is they are dropping. This has led to margins being squeezed, low profits, or lower profits, I would say, vis-a-vis the previous years. Brexit has had its own set of challenges, even though I'm sure all of you realize that it's more of a hype which has been created. In the true sense, what is Brexit going to lead to? Does anyone know? I'm throwing this question. Sorry? The trade agreements between? No, they have to definitely honor those. Trade agreements cannot be. But once Britain actually exits the European Union, does any one of us, or for that matter, does even UK know for that matter whether it's going to impact them and in what sense or what aspect? Okay. Okay. So in more specific terms, maybe the real estate sector would be impacted. The currency has been impacted. The pound has fallen. I think the maximum fall it has had in the last 30 years. So on and so forth. The idea behind all this is, of course, you can get into more details if there's a separate session on Brexit. But what we are talking of is we are just setting the context that these are the things which are there. A lot of hype is being created, but we don't really know how this will impact eventually. There's a lot of geopolitical uncertainty and conflict. The region I work in, we are seeing there are lots of conflicts which are going on. There is unpredictability. I think earlier in the day someone spoke about the VUCA world. There is volatility, there are risks which are going up. Okay, terrorism is becoming a big concern. And in number of countries in the Middle East, there is the issue of ISIS. Okay. And directly or indirectly, lots of economies and sectors are getting impacted as a result of that. Coming specifically to the Middle East and North African region, the MENA region as we call it, what have low oil prices done? Would anyone like to comment? Just one person at a time. It has impacted few countries' economies, bang on. The countries which have been primarily dependent upon oil, and one of the countries where I work, that is one of the countries which has been impacted to an extent. What is happening is that in countries like Saudi Arabia, if you take for an example, this is the first time ever that they are having a budget deficit. You know, they would always have a budget surplus, but they have started having a budget deficit, and they are looking at investment into their country, and they have dropped the threshold. Earlier it used to be minimum $5 billion to something like $1 billion now. And they are looking at listing their largest oil company. You've heard of Saudi Aramco? Yes? So again, a fallout of that, some of the GCC stands for Gulf Cooperation Council. There are six countries in that: UAE, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, Bahrain, Qatar, and Oman. So these six countries, which are primarily driven by oil, some of the sovereign wealth funds, the wealth funds which are owned by the governments, they've started issuing bonds to raise funds, to raise money, because the low oil prices have led to, as I said sometime back, budget deficits. In addition to the sovereign wealth funds, what is happening is that lots of banks, power companies, telecommunication companies, they are trying to fund their own deficits in terms of lower revenues, whatever they are having, or lower profits. In order to continue with their operations, they are raising money through bonds. And this is a study which Bloomberg has come up with recently, which talks about this. There's an impact on government spending in terms of the projects which are being taken up. You understand what SME sector is? Small and medium enterprises. Now, if you talk of a country like UAE, it is something which is, first of all, the demographics are very, very peculiar. Almost 80 to 82% of the total population of UAE is expat. It's only 18 to 20% of the population which is local. So with this kind of a transient population, lots of, while there's a big scope as far as SME sector is concerned, most of the SME sector is owned by, or the organizations in the SME sector are owned by expats. So what is happening is, because of low oil prices, lower margins, lower profits, lower revenues, there are defaults which are happening on borrowings, on operations, or whatever. The industry which I come from, banking, there's a lot of consolidation which is going on. The largest of banks in the country are merging. Okay. Can someone tell me how many banks are there in India? Number. Private sector banks, private banks, international banks, all put together. Around 66 or 65? Yeah? Now, UAE as a country has 55 banks. Okay? And what is the difference in the population? UAE has a population of about 9.5 million. Vis-a-vis India, which is 1.25 or 1.23 billion. Okay? So, what is happening is, and this is relevant for all of us as professionals, whether you're working in that market or not, but I'm giving you a perspective since I'm working there, that there's a major consolidation which is happening, and the plan is to move from 55 banks which are there right now to probably just 6 or 7 large banks. Okay, this is something which I'll avoid getting into too many technical aspects of banking, but the net-net thing which is there is that there is a drainage of funds from the economy, from the system as such. Okay. Introduction of VAT is another thing which is becoming a reality in the economies of the Middle East and North African region. Some of those already have taxation, the likes of Egypt and all, which are from the North African belt. But the GCC countries, which I just mentioned, the 6 countries, they never had any kind of taxation. And they are looking at introducing some kind of a value-added tax. As of now, they will not tax the incomes of individuals, but they will introduce some indirect taxation in order to plug their budget deficits. So this is the scenario, or this is the context in which we are operating. And at a very macro level, if you look at, the only thing which is certain is that success won't be easier. So as young student managers, as young professionals who are at the threshold of a corporate career, it is important for you to understand that at a global level, businesses are not going to have success the way it used to be earlier. There is going to be competition which will keep on growing. The profits or the margins will keep shrinking. And an organization which is successful and an organization which is not so successful, there'll be a very small differentiation in the two. Do you agree with whatever is put here? I know some of you have already reached the beta state of the brain, right? I can see that around the hall. Any comments on this, whatever I said so far? I don't want to just keep going on and on with the presentation and just have a one-way dialogue or a monologue. Yes, please. I think that's a very important point you have made in terms of the life expectancy or the average life expectancy of global 500 or Fortune 500 organizations. It is coming down by a factor of almost 15. And there used to be a time when we used to talk of long-term scenario planning, when we talk of strategic planning. And that long-term planning was for a period of 10 years or 15 years. And today, even with a 1 year annual strategic plan, there are so many uncertainties which are there. Even to do a scenario planning of 1 year is becoming difficult. Yes, any other comment? No other comments? What is happening in banking as a result of all these changes at a macro level? Mobile wallet, omnichannel. Okay, so the whole paradigm is shifting, and that is captured very well in this last line. That banking is not something, or it's not somewhere that you go, but it is something that you do. And this is where the discipline or the stream which this institute represents, telecom, that comes in very, very handy and important in terms of convergence. Because everything in today's world, as far as banking is concerned, whether it's banking in terms of a deposit, whether it's in terms of a regular transaction, or it's in terms of a lending to a corporate, anything, it's all going to be enabled through technology. Yes? Any comment on this? So with all these challenges for professionals who are at the threshold, as I said, of career, what needs to be done is you need to build sustainable competence. Yes? Now, some of the takeaways which I would like to, or some of the things which I would like to bring out. When I, as a recruiter, used to go to a campus to look at in terms of competencies, some of the things which are extremely important from my perspective, and I have listed these over the next couple of slides, I would like to bring these out over here in terms of what someone like me would look at. In an individual. Of course, there is no substitute for your domain knowledge. If you're getting into an organization, if you're applying to an organization, and if you're applying for a particular discipline, you have to have the conceptual understanding and conceptual prowess. Okay? You have to talk Turkey in terms of how business is done. If you're joining a telecom operator, you should know very well, in a prepaid business, for example in mobile, how business is going to be done. If you're talking of marketing in particular, what are the various channels, what are the various products, how these products are developed, what is the life cycle of a product, how it is looked at, so on and so forth. One very important element when you talk of knowledge or know-how is learn, learn and learn. And I have put this word three times to basically drive home the importance of lifelong learning. Learning is something which you cannot substitute with anything else. The day you stop learning, you stop growing. The second aspect is understanding what you really want to do. If you're specializing today in marketing, for example, is that something which you want to do for the rest of your life? If you're specializing in another stream, maybe finance or operations management or HR or whatever, is that what you want to do for the rest of your life? Or whether you want to be in business management at all? Okay, I'm questioning the fundamental premise which brought you into this institution. Do you really know? I can see the energy is dropping here quite drastically. Yeah, as it is, I was given a very wrong time to come and present. Yeah? So how many of us are clear that yes, we want to do or we wanted to do business management, and it's not our parents or our, it's because of the peer pressure or something that we've been forced into it. Everyone wanted to do business management, and within that, telecom. Some of you are unsure. That whether you wanted to be in BITM or could it have been whatever the other institutions are for HRD or international business. BITM? So it's a resounding yes for BITM, yeah? So good, because this is the second important aspect, because I have a lot of examples in my 2.5 decades of career where people have started with a particular specialization, but just within a few months of joining as management trainees, they felt that this was not something which was for us. We should have been in something else. I can instantly recall two examples of one individual who specialized in HR, but just one and a half years down the line, he felt that this is not his cup of tea. And he went on to do another specialization in finance. And today he is one of the most successful finance professionals. So all of you realize that, or you understand that telecom is your cup of tea, right? Okay, I just want to show you a small 3-minute video on following your heart, and this is a brief voiceover with, of course, a very inspiring visual by Steve Jobs and Alan Watts, both put together. Okay.
You can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards. So you have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in your future.
Just a minute. Apologies for that. Sorry.
You have to trust in some. You can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect them looking backwards. So you have to trust that the dots will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something, your gut, destiny, life, karma, whatever. Because believing that the dots will connect down the road will give you the confidence to follow your heart, even when it leads you off the well-worn path. And that will make all the difference.
What would you like to do if money were no object? How would you really enjoy spending your life? Well, it's so amazing. As a result of our kind of educational system, crowds of students say, well, we'd like to be painters, we'd like to be poets, we'd like to be writers, but as everybody knows, you can't earn any money that way. Another person says, well, I'd like to live an out-of-doors life and ride horses. If you say that getting the money is the most important thing, you will spend your life completely wasting your time. You'll be doing things you don't like doing in order to go on living, that is to go on doing things you don't like doing. It is stupid. Better to have a short life that is full of what you like doing than a long life spent in a miserable way. And after all, if you do really like what you're doing, it doesn't matter what it is, you can eventually turn it, you can eventually become a master of it. The only way to become a master of something, you really would have. And then you'll be able to get a good fee for whatever it is. But it's absolutely stupid to spend your time doing things you don't like in order to go on spending things you don't like and doing things you don't like and to teach your children to follow in the same track. And so, therefore, it's so important to consider this question. What do I desire?
Your time is limited, so don't waste it living someone else's life. Don't be trapped by dogma, which is living with the results of other people's thinking. Don't let the noise of others' opinions drown out your own inner voice. And most important, have the courage to follow your heart and intuition. They somehow already know what you truly want to become. Everything else is secondary. You've got to find what you love, and that is as true for work as it is for your lovers. Your work is going to fill a large part of your life, and the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And the only way to do great work is to love what you do. If you haven't found it yet, keep looking, and don't settle. As with all matters of the heart, you'll know when you find it. And like any great relationship, it just gets better and better. You can't connect the dots looking forward. You can only connect.
Okay, other than the claps or the applause, what is the learning from this? One at a time, please. Just raise your hand and make the comment. Yes. Follow your desire, which was the caption here. Beyond that. Okay, very well put. If you don't follow your heart, you will end up doing something, first of all, which you don't like. Secondly, you're following or you realize. Okay, but they come and realize, there are people I've had examples of who say that, oh, we are very good in handling customers, external customers, that is, everyone handles customers, but handling external customers. And after a point of time, they feel that, no, our, you know, heart lies in something different. We cannot deal with external customers day in and day out. Yeah, some other comments? Yes. I think very well put. How many of you are driven by money only? Be honest, come on. Good. I like the honesty around this hall. You know, after 24 years in my career or in my corporate life, yes, when I was at your stage in the career, we felt that money is the only thing. Today I maintain that money is important, but it's not the only thing. Again, it may sound a bit philosophical, a bit too esoteric, but if you follow what you truly like, in terms of this, follow your desires, money will come automatically to you, because you'll be so good at what you do that you will command a premium for that and not just be one of the also-rans. And I think that is an important aspect when you talk of sustainable competencies. Yes, knowledge is extremely important. That is the baseline competency. Without your domain knowledge, you cannot be anywhere. The domain knowledge is going to ensure that you get a foot in the door. But in addition to that, if you really involve yourself, if it comes intrinsically to you to do something and you're really good at it and better than your peer group, only then you're going to excel in that. Okay, so we move forward. You know, the things which I am putting here, this, it's not rocket science. This is something which all my co-speakers will also talk about probably. But these are things which are universal and they need to be borne in mind as young student professionals who want to build careers. You know, the Japanese style of management of being extremely process oriented and all is fine. But at the end of the day, what organizations look for are or is end result orientation, sense of urgency. Okay, if you're going to be too process oriented and you feel that you want to be a perfectionist and you want to do everything in the best fashion and not achieve your end result, it's not going to hold ground at all. So bias for action with a sense of urgency. Everything in today's world, and when you talk of VUCA world, everything is do it now. Gone are those days or years when you had the luxury of planning for something and then delivering it. Yes, planning is important. I'm not in any way trying to say that planning is not required or should not be done. It is important, but it has to be with an end result orientation and it has to be in the least possible time. And more so for the kind of industries you're targeting, which is primarily telecom and information technology and probably ITES. The world is ambiguous, it is uncertain. We've looked at the context at a global level, at a regional level. So you are going to be in very, very ambiguous situations. Don't expect anything structured to be given. As young MBAs or as young PGDMs, it's very good to have ideas. And you know, all of us as fresh MBAs, we want to give a lot of ideas to the organization we join. So ideation is very good. But what separates a successful MBA or a successful professional from a not so successful one is execution. Yeah? Implementation is the key. Any comment on this? Yes.
Sir, usually strategies are good, but execution I've seen there's always gaps.
Okay.
Like usually, say about 80% of the times are gaps.
So what needs to be done?
Same question. How do we as managers fill those gaps?
See, the best of strategies are no good around the world. And this is something which if you read any of the passages or articles or books by, you know, Kaplan and Norton, the two guys who came up with the balanced scorecard. And now, of course, they are part of the Palladium Institute. If you look at any of their researches or even researches by other people around the world, strategy is good. But if that strategy cannot be achieved and implemented, it's of no use. Yes. Okay. Yeah, I mean, irrespective of which party did what I'm trying to drive home is that while it's very good to give ideas, and as management trainees, when you will get into organizations, the ones who are in the third semester today and they are going to be, you know, next year, you're going to join organizations around the country or possibly around the region or around the world, you'll be obviously bubbling with ideas, and when you enter a new organization, you feel everything is wrong with that organization, and whatever you've studied over the last 2 years, it's all, you know, something which is to be implemented and applied. Yes, it is to be. But then you have to look at what is implementable. You have to temper it vis-a-vis the organization's context, and you have to yourself take the ownership that, fine, I have given this idea, I'll take it to implementation. And not just give 10 ideas to your boss and when it comes to implementation, you're not there. Yeah? This term I have borrowed from, I was interacting recently with one of the Harvard professors in connection with an advanced management program for which we nominated one of our senior executives. And I was just talking to him in terms of what is it that Harvard Business School looks at in its students, okay, while they are being enrolled for a program in management, okay, which is typically an MBA. And what they want to be developed as a competency which would hold their students in good stead. And I mean, I'm sure no one of you would contest that Harvard Business School is one of the best business schools in the world. Yeah? So he mentioned this term, habit of leadership. Okay? What he said was, what do I make out from that coughing which is going around the hall? Okay, no, that is just in a lighter vein. What he said was, they look for students, or they look for developing these competencies in their students later on as they go along 1.5 to 2 years of their program, in terms of taking ownership, in terms of handling everything on their own, not getting intimidated by any roadblocks, not getting intimidated by any kind of obstacles which come about, but handling things on a turnkey basis. Does this gel with you? Habit of leadership? which is related to this next point. See alternatives, not roadblocks. Yeah? Would anyone like to share an example, the ones who've just recently been through their summer internships? An example, a very brief one of this one, which they did. Then it would prove that yes, around this hall, this is a competency which is being looked at by this institution. Any example? How many of you have been through summer internships now, recently? Quite a few. Great. So these are all third semester students? Then fantastic. If I thought maybe some of you are from year one. Yes? You are, okay. Is there a roving mic which you could pass on over there? If you can share very briefly, yeah.
So, sir, during my internship, I was working in an IT company and my work was lead generation. So, I was generating leads and my sales team was too busy and the meetings were there in Mumbai. So, I asked my boss that we have to send some people to do that meeting. So, he said that no, the sales team is too busy. So I figured out a way, sir. I took up their permission, and I, being a trainee, asked for the permission to go and do that meeting myself. And then those meetings turned out to be a successful one.
Fantastic. Good. That deserves an applause. So always look for an alternative. Always look for another way of doing something, of course. It has to be above board. It has to be in the interest of the organization you're going to work for. Build that habit of leadership. That's extremely important. Which is related to this, focus on what you can impact positively. Have meaningful networking. Of course, this is something which is very obvious. But I've deliberately put that word meaningful within inverted commas because we are all living in a network world. We all have fantastic, you know, lists of our LinkedIn and Facebook connections and whatnot. But how many of those are meaningful? Yeah, think about it. How many of these will help you in furthering your cause as a professional? In today's world, all of us know, and it's very obvious, that without networking, you cannot survive. But how much of this network is meaningful to you, and not meaningful only in a very selfish and self-centered kind of a aspect. It obviously has to be on a mutual or a mutually beneficial kind of a thing. But just think about it in terms of what kind of network you have, whether it is meaningful or not. I've put this term KYC, know your customer. This is a term, of course, from a regulatory aspect of banking, which all of you know if you hold bank accounts. But I want to drive home the importance of customer primacy, that you have to understand your customer, whether it's an external customer you're servicing or it's an internal next in line within the organization. For some of you who are finance, were finance specialization guys, for you, yeah, your customers will be within the organization. And the same holds true for people like me who are in HR. The rest of the organization is a customer. For the ones who are into sales or who are into marketing, or even within marketing, whether it's brand management or product management, you have external customers. So know what your customer requires, and it's stating the obvious, I don't want to dwell too much on it. Another very important competency which is important if you have to have a sustainable growth in the organization. And that is in terms of, while the jargon is walking the talk, but what I am putting it as is inspiring trust, doing what you say and saying what you do. Okay? And if you go to Stephen Covey and his seven habits principle and so on and so forth, one of the things which he talks about is trust. And even in leadership, in seven habits of highly effective managers, the key element when it comes to the discipline of high impact leaders, it is inspiring trust. And as young professionals, you have to inspire the trust in your managers, amongst your colleagues, whether it's peers or it's your entire role set. And if you do this, it is going to help you and hold you in good stead. You'd like to see a video by Robin Sharma? How many of you have read his book? Not the monk who sold his Ferrari, but the one on leading without title, the leader who had no title. Anyone? Okay, I'll show you a distillation of that, very, very brief, of course, in this video, Lead Without a Title.
Here's an idea for you. See yourself as an artist when you go to work every day. See yourself as someone who gets to create a masterpiece through your work regardless of what you do. I think every single one of us has a need for creative expression. We all have in our hearts a longing to go to work every day and to create. That's part of what makes us special. Actually, let me put it this way. We all have a creative longing to realize our potential. It's one of the most fundamental of all human hungers. How do you get there? Go to work every day. See yourself as an artist. Be brilliant at what you do. It makes you feel so good. Focus plus time equals genius. Most people, Edison was asked, you know, Edison is a fascinating guy. He had close to 2,000 patents in his life. He was asked, what's the secret of your genius? You know what he said?
Sorry for this interruption. Are you able to follow his accent clearly? Because the audio is slightly unclear, and I don't know why he's decided in this particular video to be too much of Canadian accent. Yeah, if everyone is able to follow, we'll go on. Yeah, you want me to start all over again? You're saying yes to everything.
Here's an idea for you. See yourself as an artist when you go to work every day. See yourself as someone who gets to create a masterpiece through your work regardless of what you do. I think every single one of us has a need for creative expression. We all have in our hearts a longing to go to work every day and to create. That's part of what makes us special. Actually, let me put it this way. We all have a creative longing to realize our potential. It's one of the most fundamental of all human hungers. How do you get there? Go to work every day. See yourself as an artist. Be brilliant at what you do. It makes you feel so good. Focus plus time equals genius. Most people, Edison was asked, you know, Edison is a fascinating guy. He had close to 2,000 patents in his life. He was asked, what's the secret of your genius? You know what he said? Most people get up every day, they do many things. I get up every day, I do a few. That is the secret of my mastery. Picasso one day was in a market, and a woman saw him. She said, Mr. Picasso, it's great to see you. I'm a huge fan. He said, nice to meet you. She said, Mr. Picasso, she pulled out a piece of paper and a pencil. Mr. Picasso, can you do a little piece of art for me? Can you do a little drawing? He said, absolutely. Did a beautiful drawing. She looked at it, she said, oh, Mr. Picasso, fantastic. She starts walking away. He goes, oh, my dear lady, that'll be $1 million. She said, Mr. Picasso, $1 million, it took you 30 seconds to do that. He said, my dear lady, it took me 30 years to do that in 30 seconds. When we look at the Bonos of the world, when we look at the leading sales professions of the world, when we look at the best leaders without title, when we look at the masters of HR, the masters of R&D, we look at the best business people, we say, she's gifted, she's smarter than me, she's better with people than me, she just somehow knows more than me, she's got a better education, she had an easier background, she got lucky. You've heard the cliche because it's true, the harder I work, the luckier I get. I'm here today, I'm an ordinary person, but I focused on my craft. I had a burning desire to be excellent. I love what I do. What I do, this leadership message, sharing in my books and speaking is my oxygen, it's my DNA. 4 a.m. I get up and I'm working on my craft because I love it. I love it. I think I know every single one of us can be a genius quicker than you think. Quicker than you think. But if you focus on all things, then to be all things to all people, you can never really get to mastery or specialty. So be stunningly good at what you do on this first big idea of leading without title. Secondly, and by the way, you know, I have found that there's a lot of stress in our world. Would anyone agree with me there's a lot of stress in our world? And sometimes when we become under stress or we're busy being busy, we forget about focusing on what's most important. Allow me to share with you one of my favorite stories on stress. I was in a grocery store a little while ago, and I saw a mother pushing her baby. And this baby was crying, screaming like you can't imagine. And I overheard the mother saying, "Don't scream, Jennifer. Don't yell, Jennifer. Be calm, Jennifer." So friends, I couldn't help myself. I walked over to this woman. I said, "Madam, I can't tell you how impressed I am by the way you're speaking to your baby." And she looks at me and she says, "No, I'm Jennifer." Ladies and gentlemen, every time you blame your background, every time you blame your boss, every time you blame your clients, every time you blame the culture, you're literally giving away your power to influence. You are giving away your power to be the change you want to see in the world, as Gandhi said. I think it's an impotent way to live to say it's because of other people and it's because of circumstances that I'm not playing my best game. My life changed when I realized a simple idea, which is life is a mirror. And life gives us not what we want. Life gives us who we are. And it's amazing what happens as you walk out in the world and as you begin to take responsibility for leading without title, for adding more value, for inspiring people more, for innovating where you're planted, for building relationships, for being the nicest person that you know, what begins to happen through an organization and through your life? Absolute personal responsibility. Fourth point, become outrageously enthusiastic. And again, you're going to say, "Robin, let's hold hands and sing Kumbaya." You know, being enthusiastic isn't important. Next thing you're going to tell me is get up in the morning and look in the mirror and saying, I think I am. I like myself. But isn't it true that the most enthusiastic person in the room influences people? And they elevate people, and they encourage people. Another issue of Fortune magazine a little while ago did a story on Richard Branson's Necker Island conference. He invited all sorts of amazing people. And the reporter in the room said something I've never forgotten. The reporter said, "It was striking to me how in each of the conference sessions, the moguls of these giant firms were always the most enthusiastic people in the rooms. It's amazing to me when I meet world-class CEOs. They are the most humble, the most passionate, they are the most engaged, they are the most lively people in the room." I think it's fundamentally important to be the most enthusiastic person you know. I think in so many ways, leadership is about inspiring people by your example. And children are masters of this. Children know these fundamentals. Just a little point on how children remember the simple things. My son Colby is 13. He turned 13 a few months ago. And I believe a child only turns 13 once. So I wanted to create an unbelievable experience for my son Colby. And I'm going to do the same for Bianca when she turns 13. So I decided to take Colby to New York. And I wanted to do an amazing, amazing weekend for Colby. So we had food at my favorite restaurant. We stayed at my favorite hotel. We went to FAO Schwartz. We went to the play Wicked. It was absolutely incredible. That night, Sunday night, on the way home on the airplane, I said to Colby, I said, Colby, what was the most unforgettable thing about our weekend together? A special father and son weekend. You know what he said to me? He said, Dad, on Saturday afternoon when we were sharing that simple pastry on the street, talking and laughing, he said, Dad, that was my favorite moment. It's the simple things that are essential to leadership, the simple things that are essential to life. Be the most enthusiastic person you know. And then the final tactic, give the extra 1%. Leadership doesn't happen when things are easy. Leadership is about how you show up when everyone else feels like going home at the end of the day. Leadership occurs on the extra mile. Leadership occurs when everyone has laughed at your idea. Leadership occurs when you feel like giving up and you reach into yourself and you pull out what Carmichael, who is Lance Armstrong's coach, said, the final 1%. He said what made Lance Armstrong great was everyone else gave up at the end, but he kept that final 1% in reserve. And when everyone else was exhausted and everyone else felt like giving up, Lance Armstrong reached deep within, and that final 1% is what made him world class. Here's an idea for you. See yourself as an artist when you go to work every day. See yourself as someone who gets to create a masterpiece through your work.
So what do you think? Awesome. What are the key learnings? Of course, there was a slide which he had put up as a part of that talk in Microsoft. Which were these 5 points? So any comments? Be stunningly good at what you do. Yeah, and it kind of resonates very well with the three or four slides I put forth on sustainable competence. The first and foremost point was about domain knowledge or the know-how as such. Whether it's domain knowledge, whether it's in terms of understanding of the business, the kind of organization you work for, so on and so forth. Be stunningly good at what you do. And these are the five qualities which have been distilled by Robin Sharma as important if you want to lead. And it's not about what is written on your business card. It's not about the size of your office. Leadership is not about that. Leadership is about what you want to do. If you're doing that, if you're making that work for the benefit of the organization, you're a leader in your own right. And it has nothing to do with the hierarchy. So as young professionals, for sustainable competence, whatever attributes have been put forth, and there are lot many, I'm not saying that these are the only ones. I've tried to put across a few important elements which according to me are important. These, what Robin Sharma has just presented, these are quite congruent with, and they again tie up with that. And incidentally, these are all timeless. They are not contextual in that sense. They hold true universally. Yes or no? Be stunningly good at what you do. And he gave two very powerful examples. Let's hear from you. Which was the first example he gave in that? Thomas Edison before Picasso. Yeah. where he gave a very important lesson on focus. He said, when Edison was asked, you know, what makes him what he is, he said, most of the people in the morning, they do so many things, and I do few things. It doesn't mean to say that if you're assigned a work in an organization, doesn't mean to say that you'll do it selectively, but the point is, the essence of this whole thing is focus. Yeah? Focus on what you do best, and you will be the best. The second example was of Picasso. Yeah? For a 30-second drawing, he charges, or he asks for $1 million, and he says that it's taken him 30 years to do what he did now in 30 seconds to command that kind of a premium. So be so good in your craft, in your professions, that you would command that kind of a premium. And if we go back to the first video, don't go after the money. Because if you go after the money, what happens? It may sound very idealistic, but then it holds true. If you do what you do best every day, money will follow. If you go after money, maybe you'll get that in a short term, but in the long term, I don't know. Because we are talking of sustainable competencies. We are not talking of something which will help you in the next 1 or 2 years or which will help you in the next 5 years or so. But sustainable over a period of time as you work in an organization. Have striking clarity of vision. Any comments on this? What example was there in this 8-minute video? Sorry? That was with respect to the first one, but yes, it relates to the second one too. Be an artist. Anything else which struck you from this whole thing? No excuses. Very good. Don't unnecessarily complicate things. Keep things simple. Brexit. I think the world is overcomplicating the fallout of Brexit. No one knows as of now what will be the real impact. I'm just giving an example. You know, the last give the extra 1%. I am reminded of a very, very powerful example or a very powerful instance from one of the interactions I had with one of the stalwarts in the telecom industry, which is Mr. Sunil Mittal, Sunil Bharti Mittal. I used to work for Bharti Airtel, as you know from my profile. And in those days, we were at in the year 2000, Bharti was at an inflection point where from a very manufacturing kind of a mindset, it decided to move into services. Okay, that was the year 2000, sometime around August. And I had the fortune of joining that organization sometime in September 2000. And one of the annual conventions which we were having, and at that time Bharti used to be relatively small, Bharti Televentures Limited, as the holding company was called at that point of time. We were around 4,000 odd people, relatively smaller than what it is today. So, one-to-one interaction, I had the opportunity, and I used to quite frequently meet Sunil ji. So, he was addressing a small group of the people who were in that convention. This was an HR professionals within the Bharti group, their annual meet. So, what he said was that he believes in doing 100 things 1% better. You follow me? 100 things 1% better rather than trying to do one thing 100% better. Yeah. And it kind of relates to what Robin Sharma said in the last bit of his video over here. Give that extra 1%. If we go back to my earlier slides in terms of what will differentiate a success from a failure, it is going to be that small difference between a leader and an also-ran. So that 1% difference, and that 1% is, again, it's not to be taken in a, you know, quantitative sense that it has to be a 1% difference between, you know, one thing and another, but that infinitesimal difference or that marginal difference can create the difference between a success and a failure. Yeah? How are we doing on the time, Professor? Time is up. Okay, I want to show just 1 3-minute video as the last parting shot. Okay, you've heard of a guy called Nick Vujicic? Okay, so you've seen his videos, then I will not show it. Yeah? So we can do away with it? Or you want to see it? You want to see?
It was a surprise to my parents that their firstborn son was going to be born without limbs. When they saw me, the doctor saw me, and they said, "Sorry, we have no explanation." And still to this day, it remains a mystery. They called it phocomelia, which means being born without limbs for. It was a surprise to my parents that their firstborn son was going to be born without limbs. When they saw me, the doctor saw me, and they said, "Sorry, we have no explanation." And still to this day, it remains a mystery. They called it phocomelia, which means being born without limbs for no medical reason. It was definitely difficult in those fragile early years of childhood, and even in teenage years, trying to work out the truth of my value, that it's not determined on whether I have arms and legs or not, or how many friends I have. And I just took it one day at a time, and realizing that we're all different, but I don't need to be someone I'm not. I just need to be the best me I can be. I love swimming, just for recreation and floating, and just a very peaceful thing that I do for relaxation. Because I have no arms and legs that weigh me down, I actually float like a life vest. I've learned how to move around the pool and even in the ocean and even on a surfboard. It was an incredible experience jumping out of a plane at 13,500 feet. That experience of free falling was one of the most freeing and just, this is cool. And so to me, it was a great, fun, unique experience. I mean, I love adrenaline. I really, really do. I will never do it again. really only because I'm now a father.
Look how beautiful my boy is.
Oh, I miss him so much.
At 17, my janitor at my high school, we made friends, and he looked at me one day and he, to my surprise, said, "You're going to be a speaker." And I said, "You're a crazy old man." I said, "What do you think I'm going to speak about?" He said, "Your story." I said, "I don't have a story." He said, "Yes, you do."
My doctors never thought that I'd be able to walk, and today, I'm walking.
For anyone who's embarking on a new season or chapter in their life, for instance, in corporate America, it was a big, big step for me to move from Australia to Los Angeles, and you always have obstacles. When we live in such a competitive world, it's very easy to talk yourself out of trying again. It's very easy to talk yourself out of doing anything new. But if that's within you and in your heart and your mind and your spirit, this is what you need to move forward in, then go for it. And don't be afraid to fail. Because even if you do fail, you're not a failure. Failure is education. We're all outsourcing overseas, but there are many people that I know who are looking for jobs, who have different disabilities, and I think it's part of that corporate social responsibility that maybe perhaps American corporations can really invest in on. It's not just giving someone a wheelchair or a building to access, it's about inspiring them as well to get up and go create something. You know, I at best was thinking, well, I hope I get a job, and here I am, a president of two companies and employing, you know, over a dozen people here in America. And we're just thankful that that in itself is hopefully inspiring to others to say, wow, you know, what am I complaining about? You know, if some other people are reaching for dreams, then I'm going to try and do my best. And, you know, many people who look at people with success, they often forget that we all start with zero. And so don't be afraid to work, don't be afraid to try, don't be afraid to network, and don't be shy. You know, don't be ashamed of anything. You know, just go out and try, and you never know who you may inspire along the way. It was
so no excuses, don't be afraid to try. What else? Don't feel shy. Of course, don't be afraid to try. Related to that, don't have fear of failure. I think the key lesson for all of us around this hall is no excuses. Look for alternatives. Don't get impacted by roadblocks. You will have a lot of obstacles, you'll have a lot of roadblocks as you get into your professions and into your careers. Don't offer excuses, offer solutions. Yeah? With this last quote, or with this quote from John Maxwell, I would like to thank all of you for being patient listeners. What questions do you have? I'll be glad to take those. Thank you. Is this applause celebrating the end of the session or what you went through? Okay, what questions do you have? You can raise your hand and the volunteers can just hand over the mic to you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
I'm Kirti Radhakrishnan from VMHRD Marketing. So my question to you is that Middle East countries like Saudi Arabia and all, earlier tax was not imposed. Now they are thinking of imposing taxes. So what will be the impact after the taxes being imposed?
Impact on?
Overall, the country.
Okay, overall, once the taxes are imposed, if the tax is on individual incomes, it is definitely going to impact the ability of that region to attract talent. Because why a lot of talent is attracted to that part of the world, whether it's from Europe, the mainland Europe or UK, or whether it is from the subcontinent, it's because of no taxability right now. So definitely that will be adversely impacted. Does that answer your question?
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Rajat from BIM Marketing.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, in one of your slides, you mentioned that you have to learn and learn to grow in this environment. So in this VUCA environment everyone is talking about, don't you think instead of learning, unlearning and relearning is more important?
I think you've put it very well. When I say learn, unlearning is an inherent part of any learning. if you look at a typical learning model, the first and foremost step, if you go back to your concepts, is unlearning. Because any kind of a sustainable change happens only when you unlearn, you learn, and then you bring about a consistency in implementing what you've learned. So, very valid point. Yes, unlearn, but learn, learn, and learn has unlearning as an inherent element of it.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir. Yeah, in front of you.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm Rahul Rawal from BITM Marketing. I want to share that Toyota has developed engine right now, and it is working on the air compression and air suction technology. And here the it is not working on the petrol. So if the prototype is developed, so soon it will be launched into the market. So what will happen to the Gulf countries, because already the prices of the petrol is already dipping, and how the banks in the Gulf countries are gearing up to tackle this kind of situation, because there will be some economic downfall in these countries in future.
Well, I don't have an answer. Let me be very honest. Once that prototype is taken to a commercial production, and once that is brought into the market, it'll remain to be seen after that. As I said a few minutes back, scenario planning as a part of strategic planning. There was a time when we used to gaze 10 years, 15 years into the future and talk about a strategy for an organization. But today that time frame is, or the time horizon is just about 1 to 2 years. So to answer your question, at this stage, honestly, no one knows. Because even the current scenario in terms of falling oil prices, the organizations were not ready for it. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
This will be the last question.
Okay. Hi. Let's see how strong a voice you have.
Hello. Hello, sir. My question is that, sir, India is one of the fastest growing economy in the world, and India got one of the maximum FDI from UAE, that is $75 billion. So how do you see the Indian and UAE relationship for future development of both the countries?
How do I see the relationship?
Yes, sir.
You know, the first and foremost thing about the demographic profile of UAE is that you don't feel that you're in any other country. So that answers your question, because as I said some time back, 80% of the population is expat. And out of that 80%, almost, I would say 70 to 75% of that 80% population is Indian. Okay? So with this kind of a, you know, representation of the Indian community there, of course, most of these are blue collar. But just going by the sheer numbers, obviously, the relationship is going to be very, very positive, and it's going to be much more closer than what it has been. And UAE, after the recent visit of the Prime Minister, is looking at India much, much beyond than just a talent pool. Okay? Yes, it was a source for a lot of technology and a lot of things earlier, but now the degree is going up. Does that answer you?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Today, we learn about the current economic environment in global world. We also learn about the changing business scenario of banking. You also taught us to build sustainable competence as a young professional. We also learn about the key attributes of best leader. We look forward to many more such interactions on and off the dials.
Thank you, sir. May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director in Charge BITM, to present a memento to Mr. Harsh Sood.
Sir, our personal thanks to you for accepting our invite and taking up hectic travel and night stay and night journey two nights. We are really, really thankful to you for your sparing your valuable time.
Thank you, Professor. It's my pleasure. And thank you very much for not falling asleep. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Thank you for sleep.